The human tragedy is the lack of coordination between being and values. Infusing God into reality is an attempt to overcome this division, to show the direction of action. Well, the first sentence is quite interesting. The second is chilling in its fundamentalist potential. Clearly, if one embarks on a journey searching for God, dangers abound. Welcome to the next episode of Thinking Camera. In that building, I spend a lot of time talking to scholars about a giant of philosophy, Professor Marek Siemek, for a documentary review from a cathedral. Some of those exchanges contained elements that, although not included in the finished film, stayed with me, demanding my attention. Like the following.
Myślenie nie jest czymś, co można zaliczyć do kategorii ludzkich czynności czy rozmyślnych działań. Jest raczej czymś, co dzieje się w nas bez ustanku. Myślenie można porównać do bicia serca. Jest ono czymś, co dzieje się w nas, czy tego chcemy, czy nie chcemy.
Contrary to my initial intuitive reaction, thinking as involuntary, biological, a heartbeat-like process actually upgrades and not devalues its ontological position. And when this notion is articulated by a scholar in transcendental idealism, it becomes even more intriguing as a possible connecting point between sensual and cerebral, between visual and abstract. We are entering a territory here of film and philosophy, and perhaps transcendence.
Chociaż w myśleniu człowiek jest raczej osamotniony, to jednocześnie na jego przebieg mają bardzo istotny wpływ kontakty z ludźmi, z którymi zdarza nam się rozmawiać, czy których książki zdarza nam się czytać. Myślenie Marka Siemka trwa w myśleniu tych, którzy zmuszeni są trwać dalej i myśleć w dalszym ciągu.
Now, that's even a more dramatic twist. Do we have to be here and perform thinking? Are we condemned to this task? Is it a task or a way out, or both? Back in my student years, I didn't ask those questions. Instead, I, well, ranted ahead. I proceeded to write that one of possible paths in embedding reality with God is a relationship between greatness and closeness. I quoted a Polish aesthetician, Professor Władysław Tatarkiewicz, about whom I made a documentary in film school, who, in his book Pererga, noticed that these notions are inseparable in childhood, and only later on part ways. Only children and a few happy ones see those who are close to them as great. Then comes a quote from Canetti, to be as lonely as not to overlook anybody. There is only one stop there toward calling for not to overlooking God in everyone, which is easy to say, but difficult to do. I recall a confession from a dazzling beauty who said, they say, be here and now and maintain eye contact with every human being you meet. But if I do so, I would not be able to take a step in public without being harassed. End of quote. So there are no rules working as crutches to replace our moment-to-moment challenges of daily living. No rules understood as easy ways out. Each situation calls for your total focus and judgment. Meaning, if we strive to find God in every day, we better watch out not to overdo it, or misuse it, or worse, use it to belittle, squash, or even enslave. Further in the essay, I wrote, a legend says that the great documentarians throw out their best takes and make films from the rest. That's actually a vast subject. What is a documentary work process? What are the techniques of footage selection? What is it that documentarians strive for, to name just a few issues? For now, it would be sufficient to know that in my text from 40 years back, I meant that everything is important and that value lies not only in best takes. That if we lose the mechanism of selection, everything would become holy. Sadly, only an exalted and inexperienced traveler through life could be that naive. So I kept writing, clearly elated. If we immediately find value in here and now, a selection would lose its sense and we would open up to the everlasting festivities of the everyday. Cinema, through its almost instantaneous abilities to mythologize and canonize its elements, is a perfect vehicle to reinstate the closeness with greatness. And then in the text comes a preposterous sentence. Because of that ability, cinema constitutes a proof of the existence of God. Oh boy.
Trzeba mieć doświadczenie mistyczne. Sztuka nie jest twórczością, lecz jest odkryciem twórcy.
Looking at the issue from today's perspective, I think that uses of space, time, structure can indeed point to a metaphysical in a way that rivals emotions and insights one can get from visiting a cathedral or from meditating. On a film journey to discover the unity of great sacrum and everyday profanum lurks the sin of sentimentality that can be overcome with ruthlessness born out of necessity. That sentence, taken out of context, could place me in the company I really don't want to be in. The necessity will also fight off the deadliness caused by being lukewarm, which is equally repulsive to cinema as it is to theology. Furthermore, there is an apparition of Don Quixote, that victim of the split between the lofty expectations of an individual and the times that are changing too fast around him. A few dozen years back, Don Quixote would have been a true hero. In his time, however, he is only a fool or a jester at best. So, nearing the end, I asked, how can we right now connect with The Paradise Lost by Schaffner, the Czech films of Miloš Forman, The Grass Harp by Capote, or A Genial Acceptance of the World in The Glory of the Empire by Jean d'Ormesson? Even if all that seems impossible, let's not give up remembering the famous quote. Everyone became great in proportion to his expectancy. One became great by expecting the possible, another by expecting the eternal, but he who expected the impossible became the greatest of all. So that's the preliminary conclusion of this attempt to get closer to the subject. Still, in some mad way, I believe that the quote that I finished this story with still holds true. See you next time.